Hello world, welcome back. This is part 2 of the tutorial series about Survivalcraft Electronics. Before I explain the electrical components in the game, let's go a little bit more in depth on the signals. In part 1 I told that analog signals in Survivalcraft are hexadecimal. There are 16 possible hexadecimal values, and 16 is 2 to the 4th power. This is convenient because a bit has two states, 0 and 1. This means that the hexadecimal value can be used to display 4 bits of a binary value. In other words, you can make a hexadecimal value using 4 bits. A 4-let displays each of these bits individually. So, how this works, each of the bits has a value assigned to it. The first bit has the value 1, the second bit has the value 2, the third bit has the value 4, and the fourth bit has the value 8. If we only add the values together of the bits that are turned on, we get the hexadecimal value. Since a hexadecimal value is 4-bit, I will be referring to it as a 4-bit signal. There are different ways of displaying the same 4-bit signal. It can be displayed as the analog value of the battery, the hexadecimal values of the 7-segment display, or as the binary values of the 4-let. So, in Survivalcraft, analog signals are 4-bit. This analog-to-digital converter does pretty much the same thing as the 4-let, although it's more like a 4-bit-to-binary converter. Either way, the 4-bit signal is split into 4 individual bits. This component has to be placed on a wired loop block to access the 4-bit input at the back. If a connection on a component has red dots on it, it means that the connection is an output. You can do the opposite using a digital-to-analog converter. In this component, 4 individual bits are combined into one 4-bit signal. This component has to be placed on a wired loop block as well to access the 4-bit output at the back. If a connection on a component has blue dots on it, it means that the connection is an input. Now that we have a better understanding of the signals, I can show you the working of the components in the game. If there is something you don't understand the first time, don't worry, even without knowing everything, you can still make something great. And if you want, you can always come back to this video later. Either way, let's begin with one of the most basic components, the delay gate. Delay gates are used to delay a signal. A single delay gate will delay the input signal by 0.2 seconds. Two delay gates in a row will delay the signal by 1 second. And three delay gates in a row will delay the signal by 5 seconds. But it's way easier to just use the adjustable delay gate, in which you can set a custom delay between 1/100 of a second and 2.56 seconds. NOT gates will invert the input signal. So a 0 will become an F and a 7 will become an 8, and vice versa. Random generators will generate a random 4-bit signal every 1/2 a second if their input isn't connected. If their input is connected, it will only generate its random signals if the input has a high signal. So, when I press this button, it will generate a random signal. It looks like we are running out of space here. Let's quickly fix that. That's a lot better. Next up, I'll cover the logical operators. Generally speaking, logical operators are used for digital signals. All logical operators in Survivalcraft have two inputs, one on the left and one on the right. They have one output which can be accessed both at the top and at the back of the component. I'll start with the AND gate. The AND gate will only output when the first input and the second input are both activated. You can use AND gates to check if multiple factors are true. So for example, I will connect one input of the AND gate to the pressure plates and the other input of the AND gate to a switch. The output I will connect to the doors. We have now made a door lock. If one of the two inputs of the AND gate is 0, the output will be 0. Independent of the other input. If one of the inputs of the AND gate is the maximum signal, the output will be the same as the other input. This way you can use an AND gate to enable or disable a certain connection by sending a signal. Next is the OR gate. The OR gate will activate if one or both of the input signals are activated. The way a wire in SurvivalCraft mixes two signals is completely equal to how this OR gate does it. The only difference is that the OR gate makes sure that the signals flow in one direction, so that the signals of the inputs won't interfere with each other. After that is the XOR gate. The XOR gate will activate if only one of the inputs is activated. You can use this component to detect if the inputs are not equal to each other. The NAND gate is an AND gate with a NOT gate connected to its output. This component will activate when one or none of the inputs are activated. The NOR gate is an OR gate with a NOT gate connected to its output. This component will only activate if none of the inputs are activated. SurvivalCraft doesn't have NXOR gates. But if you need them, you can make them with an XOR gate and a NOT gate. If a 4-bit signal is fed into a logical operator, it will process it bit by bit. It splits both inputs into 4 individual bits, then runs each of the bits through the logical operator and then combines these 4 output bits back into a 4-bit signal. In other words, the AND gate only outputs the bits which both inputs have in common. The OR gate outputs all the bits which both inputs together have. The XOR gate only outputs all the bits which both inputs do not have in common. The NAND gate outputs all the bits except the ones which they have in common. The NOR gate only outputs the bits which none of them together have. And an NXOR gate would output all the bits which they have in common and the bits which none of them together have. For some reason, it took me years to understand this. These were all the basic components. Next, we'll start with the advanced components. We'll start with the 4-bit counter. The 4-bit counter has 3 digital inputs and 2 outputs. The main output is at the top. The input at the right marked with the plus will increment the top output value by 1. And the input at the left marked with the minus will decrement that value by 1. Whenever the value goes from the maximum to the minimum, or vice versa, it overflows. Once that happens, the bottom output will be activated. To reset the component, you'll need to activate the back input. Next, let's talk about the truth table circuit. The truth table circuit has 4 digital inputs and 1 digital output at the back. You can edit the component to select one or more of the 16 combinations of inputs. So this column which says input 4 corresponds with this input marked with the 4 dots. So does this column correspond with this input, and so on. So I'm going to set it to 0101, and when I turn these switches on, the back output activates. I've never really used this component, but you could use it for passwords. The SR latch is like a switch controlled by signals. It has 3 digital inputs and 1 digital output at the top. The set input at the left will set the output to on. The reset input at the right will set the output to off. This will be applied immediately when the clock input at the bottom is not connected. But when it is connected, the change will only be applied when the clock input is activated. The top output can also be accessed from the back of the component. The memory bank is by far the most advanced component in the game. It has 4 inputs and 1 main output at the top. The inputs at the right and left of the component are like coordinates. The right one with a single blue dot on it is the x-axis. And the left one with the 2 blue dots on it is the y-axis. You'll need these inputs to select a data location. Currently, both inputs have the value of 0, so location 00 is selected. If we edit the component, you'll see a 16x16 grid of zeros. You can tap a row to manually change its data, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. So now, if you look at location 00, you'll see that it's pointing to the value 1. So if we save and exit this menu, we'll see that it now outputs the value 1. I've incremented the right input, so now it will read the data at location 01, which gave us the value 2. And if we check it, we'll see location 01 is indeed pointing to a 2. So each time we increment this horizontal location input, it will output the next value I wrote in this row. So now I've written the data 2020 in row 2. To access this data, I'm going to set the y input at the left to 2. And there we go, 2020. So in a memory bank, you can write any data you want. This makes it very useful for all kinds of things. For example, you can use a memory bank to kind of process sensor data. If I only want this wire to turn on when I'm one or two blocks away from this motion detector, this memory bank is to output the maximum signal strength, F, when the sensor value is E or F. Or if I only want this wire to turn on when I'm 4, 5, 6 or 7 blocks away from this motion detector, the memory bank has to output the maximum signal strength when the sensor value is 9, A, B or C. If you want, you can copy the data from a memory bank. To do this, you have to tap the button that says linear. Next, tap the bar and copy the text. To paste it, edit another memory bank and tap the button that says linear, tap the bar and paste it. It's also possible to write data into a memory bank via signals. To make this possible, we'll need to connect the clock input, which is at the bottom of the component. Just like the SR latch, when this input is connected, nothing changes until it's activated. So if we go to location 00, which still has the value of 1 written into it, the output doesn't change to 1. To read the value at the selected memory location, we have to send a high signal to the clock input. The data will be read the moment the clock input reaches that signal. To write the component, all we have to do is select the location we want to write the data to. Let's say 4, 2. Next, the value which we want to write in this location has to be provided at the back of this component. So let's say we want to write a value of 3 in there. To write it, we have to send a low signal to the clock input. Note that the signal cannot be 0. The moment the clock input reaches that low signal, the data will be written inside the memory bank. And as you can see, at location 4, 2, we've written a 3. But the bank doesn't yet output the 3 we've just written. So to do that, we've got to send one more high signal to the clock input to read the data at location 4, 2. And last but not least, the sound generator. This component has 4 inputs. The top input is the volume, the input at the right is the octave of the sound, and the input at the left is the pitch. And the input at the bottom is the tone. When the tone input signal goes from 0 to a value which is not 0, it will play the sound. This value is the instrument of that sound. The easiest way to wire it up in a way that we can access all sounds of the sound generator is to connect batteries to all inputs of the sound generator except the tone input. Connect an AND gate to the tone input and connect another battery to this AND gate. This battery controls the instrument of the sound. Now all you've got to do is to place a button here to play the sound. All of these batteries are sound settings. So with this battery you can change the volume setting. The volume setting is pretty straightforward. The higher the signal, the louder the sound. Next, let's look at the instrument setting. The instrument setting has a different instrument for every signal between 0.1 and 0.9. A signal of 0.1 gives it bell sounds, a signal of 0.2 gives it organ sounds, a signal of 0.3 gives it ping sounds, a signal of 0.4 gives it string sounds, a signal of 0.5 gives it trumpet sounds, a signal of 0.6 gives it vocal sounds, a signal of 0.7 gives it piano sounds, a signal of 0.8 gives it piano sounds with sustain, and a signal of 0.9 gives it drum sounds. The pitch setting changes the pitch of the sound. It starts at 0.0 with a C, then at 0.1 comes a C sharp, and at 0.2 comes the D. This goes on all the way up to 1.1 where it has a B sound. And then it starts with the next octave, with a C at 1.2, a C sharp at 1.3, and a D at 1.4. A pitch of 1.5 mutes the sound. The octave setting shifts the pitch up by one octave at a time. The lowest octave is at 0.0 and the highest octave for most instruments is at 0.2. For the piano and a piano sustain, the highest octave is at 0.3. To be able to play the sound, make sure that the pitch input doesn't have the maximum signal, otherwise the sound will be muted. When the instrument is set to 0.9, it will play drum sounds. To select a drum sound, you'll need to set the pitch input. A pitch of 0.0 gives it a snare, a pitch of 0.1 gives it a bass drum, a pitch of 0.2 gives it a closed hi-hat, a pitch of 0.3 gives it a pedal hi-hat, a pitch of 0.4 gives it an open hi-hat, a pitch of 0.5 gives it a low tom, a pitch of 0.6 gives it a high tom, a pitch of 0.7 gives it a crash, a pitch of 0.8 gives it a ride, and a pitch of 0.9 gives it a hand clap. Here are all the tables again, so you can pause the video or take a screenshot if you want to. If you want to download any of these tables, there's a download link in the description of this video. And finally, I'll show you some useful systems. You'll start with converting a switch to a button. An XOR gate is great for detecting changes in signals, so we'll use it to detect if the current signal is equal to itself half a second ago. There you go, it converts the signal of a switch to the pulses of a button. You could use any delay you want, by the way. It'll change the length of the generated pulse. Now we'll convert a button to a switch. To convert a button to a switch, we'll use an SR latch, where both the left input and the right input are continuously activated. To do this, I use NOT gates. Connect a button to the clock input, and now the output has become a switch. Pistons won't always react to a signal from a button. This happens because the signal has quite a short pulse. To extend it, we use an SR latch. First it will be set, and after half a second it will reset. And again, you can use any delay you want here. And finally, I'll show you some clock circuits. These circuits will generate constant pulses. You can use them for rapid firing dispensers or fast counting counters. To make the fastest clock circle possible in the game, you can connect the output of a NOT gate to its input. To slow it down, just add a delay gate. To block the signal until we need it, we can use an AND gate. To get a smaller clock circuit, you can wire up a NAND gate in this way. I hope you learned something after watching this video. If there's something you didn't understand, don't worry, even without knowing everything, you can still make something great. If you want to try out SurvivorCraft 2, it's available on iOS, Android and on the Microsoft Store for Windows 10. The links are in the description. Hit like if you like this video, and if you like my videos, consider subscribing to my channel and hit the bell to get notified for every video I post.